fields. There's wine. This is my desire to honor you, Lord, with all
my God, I worship you. All I have within me, thank you.
give you my heart. This is my desire to honor you. Yes, Lord. Give you honor, Jesus. To honor you. To honor you. To honor. My desire to honor you. And though I'm weak and poor, All I have is yours, every single breath. Jesus, I'll bring you more than a song. The song in itself is not what you have required. You're looking much deeper, Lord. You search much deeper within. Through the way things appear, you're looking into of praise that are just empty. You don't want rote, you don't want rehearsed praise, Lord, but you want heart praise. And Father, we give you our hearts. We give you everything we have here tonight, Jesus. You're all we need and all we desire, Jesus. We give you everything, Jesus. It's the heart of the matter that impresses you, Jesus. It's the heart of the matter that you look upon. You don't look on our piety. You don't look on our church attendance. But you look on our hearts. You look on our hearts. And when you look this way, Father, may you see a heart that's totally yours. On fire for you, Jesus. Passionate for you. Oh, passionate, passionate for you. See a heart that's passionate for you. Not just a song, Lord. Not just a praise, Lord. Not just a sermon, not a daily devotion, Lord, but a passionate heart, a passionate heart for you. Take the world out of our eyes. Let us see you, Jesus. Take the world out of our eyes. Let us see you, Jesus. Take competition out of our eyes. Let us see you, Jesus. Take entertainment out of our eyes and let us see you. Take church building out of our eyes. Take revival out of our eyes. Take all the things about you out of our eyes so that all we can see is you, Jesus. You, Jesus. All we see is you, 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 nobody but you, 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 Jesus. Nothing else, nothing else, nothing else but you, Jesus. Nothing else but you, nothing else but you, nothing else but you, nothing else but you. Not discouragement or disappointment or anything distracts, but only you, Jesus. Sweep away the blindness. Sweep away the darkness. That all we see is the light of your eyes, Father. The light of your eyes, Father. That we can reflect you, Jesus. Oh. Some of you in this place tonight, you've made church your God. You've made church attendance your God. You've made revival your God. And see, it doesn't matter how pious the things you are that you make a God out of, any God that's not the one true God. It's not the things of God that we go after, it's God we go after. The things are secondary. It's the heart of God. It's to worship at His feet. It's to give Him all we have. It's to worship like the prostitute that was caught and forgiven. Because that's where we all are tonight. We've been caught, but we've been forgiven. I don't want to be a great preacher, Jesus. You have preachers enough to spare. And I don't want to be a great evangelist or a missionary or any of those things. If I could just learn to be a great worshiper, to say the things that you want to hear. If I could learn your heart, Lord, if I could learn your passion, then everything else, Lord, would come as it needs to. There's a word of the Lord going to someone tonight. Don't anybody get all sideways, going, you're doctrinally off, because we're called to be worshipers and followers of Jesus. And He calls us, after we become worshipers and followers, to send us into the harvest field. But sometimes we get our eyes so much on our ministry, on the will of God concerning where we're going to go next or what we're going to do, that we distract ourselves from His heart. And if He comes tonight, I want to be found at His feet, Steve, just worshiping Him. Because that's the one thing I don't know how to do. I don't know how to worship the Lord. I don't know how to say the things He wants to hear. So I ask You, Father, in this place tonight, You would put within us, Lord, the words and the passion that You need to hear from us. And all we'll be is vessels to speak it, Lord. Because we want to love You. We don't want to love You religiously. We don't want to love religion. And we love Your church, Jesus. But we don't want to love our church buildings. And we love the revival You've sent. But God, we don't want to just love revival. We want to love Your heart. Oh, let us connect with Your heart, Jesus. Show us Your heart, Lord. Show us Your heart, Lord. Let our hearts die out. Let our passions die away. But let Your passion come alive in us, Lord. Because if that happens, Father, we'll see Your kingdom on this earth. All the things we need to be about, we'll be about. If we can just see Your heart. We can just know Your heart. If we can just see Your heart. Oh, show us Your heart. Jesus, show us Your heart. We're after Your heart. We're after Your heart. We're after Your heart. Because we're coming back. We're coming back to the heart of worship. Oh, and it's all about You. It's all about You, Jesus. Oh, forgive us, Lord, for all the things that we've created, because it's all about You, that's it. It's simply about You, Jesus. It's about Your mercy. It's about Your mercy. It's about your mercy to us. While we were yet sinners, you died for us. It's about your mercy, Lord. It's about your love for your children and the love for the lost and the prodigals and those that don't know you. It's about you, Jesus. It's about your death. It's about your resurrection. It's about you, King of Kings, Lord of Lords, 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 Majesty, 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 one Lord, one Lord, one Lord, Jesus, bless your name, your blood, your power, hallelujah. Yeah, come on, lift up your voice, sing, lift up your voice, lift up your voice. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Bless his name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. There you're getting it. Yeah. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Oh, yeah. Blessed. Now, do you think we might could take the roof off of this place? Blessed be. Sing one more song, and before I quit, I don't ever do that. I usually sing and then turn it over to somebody else and they talk. Stand with me. Don't sit down yet. We're going to worship the Lord a minute more. Well, just a minute ago, I felt like the Lord really was trying to say something to people here, and I don't want to go over that. I don't want to pass through that, and I don't want you to misunderstand me. I want you to understand one thing. I'm a worship leader, but I really don't know how to worship. I'm almost taken back when people come up to me and say, Lindell, come and teach at a worship seminar and show us how to worship. I think I'm going to really know how to worship, Pastor, one day when I finally see him. I'm just practicing. I try something. But you see, church, what we've got to do, we're so honored that you're here at Brownsville tonight. We thank you for coming. But see, it's not about worshiping a move of God. And it's not about worshiping a revival. It's not about that. And it's so easy for Christians to get detached and get kind of directed over here that, oh, this is great what God is doing. Well, thank you, Jesus. But the greatest thing in the world is to worship the Lord. It's greater, listen to me, the Bible says, he that winneth souls is wise. That's a wise thing to do. That's a godly thing to do. But you know what? I can't necessarily love sinners in myself. Just by myself. There's sometimes I don't like folks. There are certain days, some family members, I would just, you know, they do me wrong and I would never tell them where to go because I'm a Christian, but I wouldn't mind too much if they went there. Now that's honest. And you know, you feel the same way too sometimes. If somebody pulls in front of you and you get mad and shake your fist and yell at them and you just went. But you see, that's what's beautiful about knowing Christ. Because when you know Jesus and when you take on Jesus and you worship at his feet, it's impossible to stay angry at people because Jesus wouldn't do that. It's impossible to hold grudges because Jesus wouldn't do that. You see, it's all about loving the lost is a wonderful thing. Our evangelist, Steve, has amazed me through the last 3 or 4 years. The way you love the lost, I'm amazed. I can't imagine. I mean, he's so passionate. You know, he's like he's charged over the love for the lost. And that's his calling and gift. And all of us as Christians, if we should love the lost, but not because we love the lost, because we love Jesus. And because it breaks his heart, because there are those who don't know him. And it should be because what Steve has preached one time, one of my favorite things he said, Pat, when you said it, Steve, scared me. You said you wanted a great big crown. And when you started that down that road, I'll never forget. I don't know if any of you seen that tape or heard that sermon. But Steve said, you know, I want the biggest crown of any of them. I don't want no scrawny crown. And boy, I remember when he said that, the crowd got quiet and everybody went, ooh, boy, he's getting a little bit caught up here, isn't he? And I was kind of wondering myself, Pastor, the first time he said it. I thought, I know Steve. I know he ain't going to say nothing wrong, but what does he mean? And he says, when Jesus puts it on my head, I'm going to push it back at his feet, and I'm going to say, no, Lord, thank you for letting me be part of this, but this is yours. And I don't ever stop worship and do this, but I feel like God is trying to speak to some folks tonight and bring you back to just loving Jesus with all your heart. I feel like there are some people here who are in ministry and you've struggled and you're discouraged and you're hurt and you're down and you're broken. And let me just give you a little bit of a word. The word is, the reason you're that way is because you've got distracted and you've started praying for God's will in your life. And that's not really scriptural. You seek the face and the heart of God, you'll know his will. Don't waste your time on those things. Go after God. Go after God. Jesus, I want more of you every morning when I get out of bed. And I'm telling you, if you'll focus back in on that and quit frustrating over what you're going to do, the Lord is here to touch you tonight, but he's going to bring your focus right back to something that you came in. What's so wonderful about worshiping Jesus? It's one of the first things we learn to do when we're a Christian, and it's so simple that we stumble over it as we come through the door, and we get caught up in all these higher things, and we forget to do the thing that God brought us into the kingdom for to begin with. And it's not worshiping in this service. It's worshiping at home. It's putting Jesus first in everything you do. It's loving on him. It's thinking on him during the day. It's praying always without ceasing. You know what that means? That doesn't mean you go around going, oh, blah, 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 blah. I mean, you'll run into somebody like that. But it's all day long having God on your conscience and talking to him and thinking on him and thinking about his goodness and thinking about Jesus, thinking about how great he is and what it's going to be like when we actually see him. And you know what? I have to stay focused on that too. But the Lord is here. He's here to touch some of you. And there's a few of you I could go lay my hands on right now. I know exactly who it is. But there's a spirit of the Lord. I never interrupt a service like this and take this kind of liberty. But I feel like God's trying to bring some focus back. Now, these things of God are not bad, okay? Don't get me wrong. But God, Jesus, is the focus. He's the reason. He's the source. He's everything. Jesus, what I want tonight, while we're in your presence, I want to ask something of you, Lord. I believe that you've opened the heavens over this church for the last 3.5, almost 4 years now. We've seen your glory. A couple nights ago, we repented. Tonight, I feel that God is speaking to us again to repent, but not for worldliness and excessiveness, just for losing our focus on you, Jesus. You are absolutely everything. There is nothing without you. Father, there is nothing made that was made without you. And Father, our joy is to worship you. And would you please forgive us? Oh, the things you give us are wonderful. The revival, we're so honored because we were starving, Lord. We were dry. We were starving. We were in a desert. We were desolate. We were hungry. We were dying. And you sent your glory back to us here at Brownsville in June of 95, and we'll never forget it. Thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you. But Lord, not even that is as important as you. And we want to thank you, Father. And we want you to know our hearts. You're all we want. You're all I want. You're all I've ever needed. You're all I want. Help me know you are near. You're all I want. Sing it, church. You're all I want. You're all I've ever needed. You're all I've ever needed. You're all I want. You're all I want. Help me know you are here. Draw me close to you. This is our prayer, Father. Never let me go. I lay it all down again to hear you say that I'm your friend. 'Cause you are my desire. No one else will do. 'Cause nothing else can take your place. Nothing, Jesus. To feel the warmth of your embrace. Help me find a way. Bring us back. Bring us back to you. I want you to sing it to the Father with all your heart. Lift up your voice. You're all I want. You're all I've ever needed. You're all I've ever needed. You're everything. You're all I want. Help me know you are. God is moving in this place. Come on, sing to him again. You're all I want. You're all I want. Move on our hearts, Father. Move, Jesus. You're all I needed. You're all I want. Help me know you are here. Help me know you. Can we do it again? One more time. You're all I want. Sing it. Come on. You're all I want. You're all. Yeah. you're near.
Help me know you are.
Jesus, Jesus, how I trust you.
Live.
love you, Lord.
Where you at, brother? I saw you down here a while ago worshiping. Where you at? Huh? There he is. All right. Hallelujah. If God has really touched your life, I want you to hold your hand up if you have a testimony. Yes, sir, back there in the white shirt. Right there. Yeah, come on up. Hold him up. Yes, ma'am, right here. Like Chaplain said, I've got an eye for this thing, folks. Yes, ma'am, right over there. The lady right there, yeah. And then we'll take, let's see, hang on. Let me see if there's anybody up in the balcony. There's one up in the balcony, couple up there. I'll tell you what, I think this will be plenty. I don't know. I think I'll take you right there. Y'all come on up. Okay. Hey, buddy. How you doing, man?
All right. How y'all doing?
What's your name?
James Emmons.
How many of y'all's heard this guy's testimony? You can be seated out there. Come on up. How many of you's heard his testimony? Did you like it? This is James. James, where do you live?
Flemington, Alabama.
Flemington, Alabama. Hallelujah. James, now we won't ask you to go through the whole story, but just tell us real quick what was your obsession that you had?
Hunting.
That was real quick, yeah. Tell us real quick. Hunting. What did you like to hunt?
Gator, hog, turkey.
What? Gator?
Yes, that was my favorite.
Gator?
It was gator, yeah.
How would you hunt them?
With a frog gig and a rifle, that's all I needed.
Yeah.
But, you know, they have a boat, too.
Did you ever get any big ones?
Yeah, we got up on some gators that kind of hissed at us when we shoot them and come off the bank and hit our boat.
But, how big were they?
We was in boats like 10 or 12 foot long, and they was longer than the boat. Yeah. I'm not lying to you, folks.
We believe you. Yeah. So gator was your favorite, huh?
Well, yeah, I got a rush off of that.
Yeah, and then hog.
Yeah, wild hog, wild turkey, you know, deer.
Deer?
Anything.
Yeah. That was in days past.
Oh, yes, sir. I was about...
How you doing this hunting season?
Oh, man, I'm winning them souls for the Lord now.
Yeah. Well, talk to us a minute.
Well,
what's God doing for you and with you?
Well, here a while back, my mama met some folks.
Is your mama here?
Yeah, she's right there.
There's your mama. Hey, stand up. Where's your sister at?
She's right there.
There's your sister. Y'all all live up in Flemington?
Yes.
You live in Bruton?
Yes.
Yeah, y'all drive a pretty good ways to get here, don't you? You joined?
Yeah.
Oh, you joined?
Yeah.
Wow. How about that? Well, God bless you. So what'd you say about your mama?
Yeah, we all, she met some people in line here a while back, and they was from Oklahoma. And the Lord spoke to my mom and told her to go to Oklahoma because these people was hungry for God. You know, they kept asking me to go, and I can't go. I had to wait on the Lord, you know. And I kept waiting and praying. I was at work. Lord, please let me go. And I got a phone call, and my mama told me, son, you got to go. You know, Lord spoke, got to go. So we loaded up, went to Oklahoma, Spiral, Oklahoma, And God just showed up in this church, y'all. It was unreal. These people were so hungry for God. I got up and gave my testimony, you know, and I looked at all these people, and they were just torn down. And my brother, he was singing Brownsville worship songs, you know, and people, when you started looking around, people was crying. So
your brother was singing?
Oh yes, he played.
Where's your brother? Is he here?
No, sir, he ain't here. He lives in, he's staying in Jay, Florida right now, but yeah, he plays the keyboard, you know, and sings a lot of worship songs from here at Brownsville. And these people are so hungry for God, and it just broke my heart to see them like this, you know, and I know God didn't send us up there for nothing.
So what'd you do?
So I gave my testimony, and my brother gave his, and my wife, and my brother's wife, and then my mother got up there, and when she got up there, I mean, it just God just come down.
Does your mama preach a little bit?
Oh, hey, you don't want...
Well, come up here a minute. I never met your mama.
But, hey, if you hand her that microphone, you may not get it back.
Hey, how are you?
Fine, I'm doing fine.
Well, so you're a member here now.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you're a member.
Yeah. Man, I love it.
Do you?
Yes, yes. At first, the first time that I came, though, I didn't like it.
You didn't like it?
No, sir. I thought the Lord just moved only one way. But
how was that?
Well, I just thought that running, that's all you're going to get to do, you know, in Pentecost a lot of times. Yeah. Run. Yeah. And I thought that's all you're supposed to, you know, that's it. Yeah. But I was sitting up in the balcony the first night. And when I was in the balcony, I said, my God, these people be ashamed of themselves acting like this. But I said,
was you Pentecostal?
Yes, sir.
You were Pentecostal all your life?
Now. But I can tell y'all something. Let me tell y'all something.
What? Wait a minute now. Assembly of God is Pentecostal.
Okay. I'm ready. The first.
You wasn't pulling my leg, what?
The first night that I came was, I didn't like Brother Kilpatrick, I'm sorry. But I didn't like Steve because I said, they ought
to. Wait a minute, you say you didn't like me or him?
Well, both of y'all.
Why didn't you like us?
Oh, I like y'all name. Yeah.
But why didn't you like us?
Well, because I said that y'all ought to be ashamed to let these people fall out like they did. Yeah. And not getting on to them.
Yeah.
And the first night, like I said, the first night I came, I told the Lord, I said, I can tell you one thing. When I get out of here, Lord, you ain't got to worry about me coming back. I have been deceived. But let me tell y'all people what happened. The very next day, I found myself getting ready. I wrote my husband a note, said, I am gone to Brownsville. Honey, when I came here, I know I was going to give my testimony because the Lord told me I was. But anyhow, he did. Yes, sir, he did. And when I came here, y'all, let me tell you, when you think you might, you know, stay 30 minutes or an hour, forget it. And go out that door, forget it. Just forget it because there's more in here. And let me tell y'all what happened to me. Y'all know how Ernest act?
Ma'am?
You know how Ernest, the guy that shakes, y'all know who I'm talking about? Y'all know who I'm talking about. All right. When I come in here...
Has he been to Brownsville?
Oh, no. But anyhow, when I was in... I needed prayer, and I was scared to death. But when one of the prayer warriors walked back there and laid their hands on me, I hit the floor... I crawled, finally got back there in that wall. Oh, my God, y'all, I spent some time on that carpet. And let me tell you, y'all, as I began to leave out of the sanctuary, I was trying to get to my car. And the further I got out there, the stronger it was. And I opened my door all right, but my steering wheel was popping. And I couldn't drive my car home, so my sister said, Lord, have mercy.
What's the matter with your steering wheel?
My God, the power of God was all over me. Woo! Woo, my God.
That's what happened.
Oh, my God. And so I couldn't, Woo!
So then you understood, didn't you? Why?
Oh, my God. Oh, my God, when I got home, my sister had to take me to the door, and I was acting like I was holding electric wire. And it lasted. I told my husband, he just put his arms around me. I said, don't you break this. I have never in my life experienced anything like this here. I promise you. And I don't go to no other church but here. I've been coming 3.5 years. And I love the Lord so much. And
What really got a hold of you? Was it your boy or your girl, or what was it?
Brother Kilpatrick, I'm the one that started here.
Oh, you was the first one.
Yeah. And then I prayed them in.
Oh, I see.
Yeah, I laid their pictures on the table over there.
Oh, I... So it was you?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Was you concerned about that boy of yours?
Oh, my Lord, yes. I tell you, y'all, he had to come to my house, and because I nailed him, and I started coming here, because, well, I got some of this joy. Coming here, you'll get something. But anyhow, he come to the house, and soon as he, the Lord said, you might as well just go ahead and nail him good. And when he come through that door, and I said, son, you don't want to hear it, but you're going to hear it. I said, you better get to that Brownsville revival. I said, man, there's some stuff going on down there. Jesus Christ is doing a work down there. You better get down there, and you better come on in and get some of this before his return. And this is what I told him.
What did he say?
Oh, Mama, I know it, Mama. Mama, I know it. You know how youngins are. Mama, I know it. And so,
how'd you get him here?
Okay. Well, you want to hear it? Well, this is what I told him. He says, I said, son, you know on Saturdays I am here. God's got me in that line out there. I'm witnessing to people out there, and I'm telling them what to expect. The Lord always told me, he said, I want you there on Saturdays, and I love the line. I love the line up. I love it, and the Lord.
Why do you like it?
Oh my God, I like it because I love the first comers. Now the second time or third time, I don't try to get involved with them too much. But the first ones that's come, man, I get them ready to come in here and to expect what's theirs, what Jesus is doing in here. But this one, I told him, I said, son, on Saturdays, you know we've got to be in Brownsville. You know, we've got to it's just a have-to thing. We just got to be here. And he said, well, Mama, you know, it's hunting season. I said, my God. I said, I'll tell you one thing. You going out there and getting in woods, but I can tell you one thing. You're not going to be satisfied out there today. And sure enough, he come out of that tree stand, buddy. He come coming through that swamp. And God has been, y'all, ever since I've been here for 3.5 years, June, a little after June, will be 4. No. But anyhow, the Lord spoke to my heart to go to Oklahoma. And Brother Kilpatrick, it's always about what's happening here. This is my story and this is my life. I went to Oklahoma because the Lord spoke to me. And you talk about some people laying everywhere all over that sanctuary. They were slung everywhere. And we brought the fire, and the Lord told me, he said, you got 3.5 revival inside. You got to go and deliver it out. Brother, I took off. He went with me. And I'm going to tell you, I began to pray for people. Oh, my Lord. And they were falling like flies. I said, Lord, I know good and well. I said, this reminds me of Brownsville. I like this. Yes, yes.
You know, Gators has got tough hides. Whenever you go in these churches where these church members have got tough hides, you bring this boy with you here. He can get them.
Oh, yes. He's good. Yes, the Lord uses him. I take him, well, whenever. Our first time was Oklahoma, and I don't know where the Lord's going to send me, but he goes.
Did you enjoy it?
It was awesome. It was awesome. You know, she come off the platform, and man, the Holy Ghost is just all over. And every time she touched somebody, it looked like somebody shot him down with a shotgun. And then it hit her, see, and I had to hold her up and take them to everybody. As she touched them, she prophesied to them, they hit the floor.
I'm telling y'all, he had to hold me up really good. You know how the anointing, when it leaves you, you're so weak, he would have to near about drag me through there.
But the main thing that I loved at the end, it was on a Sunday night, the head man, he called me in the back, and he told me, he said, what kind of people do you think we are? Because they look like Indians. I said, Indian people? He said, no, sir. You know, and I kept staring at him. I said, what kind of people are y'all? And what he told me, I like to fell out. He said, we are gypsies.
Yes, sir.
He said, we're not the gypsies that you think. And he this is what broke my heart. He asked me, he said, would y'all have came if I told y'all that we were gypsies? I said, yeah, because God said go. to see these gypsy people, y'all, running and diving at that altar and crawling to it, it was so unreal. But God just showed up, and everyone in there was just slung on the floor.
They're coming back February.
Yeah.
Well, praise God. God bless y'all. That's wonderful. Bless you. Hi. What's your name?
I'm Rachel.
And where are you from?
Cincinnati, Ohio.
Well, what's God doing in your life?
Well, let's see. The first time I came here, you and I gave the devil a black eye. Do you remember that? I had suffered from panic attacks for 18 months, and severe postpartum depression.
Yeah.
And
he's right back there.
Yeah. And at the point that I came down here, my mother prayed me here, and my best friend brought me here. And I was on Valium four times a day just to make it through the day. And
four times a day?
Four times a day. I gave Steve's wife, I had my pharmacy fax it down here, the list of medications I was on between the time my son was born.
This is it? Wow, you just happen to have this with you. Oh.
And
this is your medication?
That was what I was on when I came down.
For a day?
Well, no. Since my son was born,
yeah.
I had been going
That's to, a lot of medication.
Well, I would skip to doctors because nobody could find anything to give me strong enough to stop the panic attacks. I was up most of the night.
How many panic attacks would you have a day?
Countless, literally.
Countless?
Maybe 15.
Would they wake you up at night?
My husband and I didn't sleep. I would lay there and hold him and say, I'm dying. Would you please just hold me? I'm going to die. I was rushed to the hospital three times because we really believed I was dying. Because I don't know if any of you have ever had panic attacks. You stop breathing. And you just, because your body thinks you're getting some kind of fear, so it shuts down. We didn't know there were panic attacks because nobody had told us that. I did not know I had postpartum depression.
Had you ever had them before?
No. No.
It started just came
on. He was born. And so we were up most of the night with them. My husband would leave for work at about 8 in the morning. By 9:30, I'd call him crying, please come home. I can't do this. I just can't do it anymore. And a 3-year-old and now he's 20 months, so he was a baby then. And came down here like that. I mean, gone, done.
Wow. Come on, praise God, folks.
Doesn't stop there. I went home to my husband, who had become a Christian in 90, but I was a horrible example. I led him to Christ. I handed him a Bible. We never talked about it. We went to church on Sunday, got up, never spoke about it. That was the end of it. I came home. He had lived this with me. It wasn't just my horrible experience. It was our family. And I had told you, you asked me last time I came, or the first time I came down here, what did you come down here for? And I said to see your show, because I did not believe in the gifts of the Spirit. And it happened to me. He was talking to me. Nobody was touching me, nothing, and right here. Yeah. My husband saw the video, and he was like, that is real. I mean, he knew me, that wasn't me to do that. He was changed like that. And alcohol was poured down the drain. He had, I think, about 74 CDs from Ozzy Osbourne, Led Zeppelin. All the ones that he had loved for years were gone. He is applying to the School of Ministry in fall. You have no idea. I'm sorry?
We're moving here.
That's great. So, it's like...
And so what happened to the panic attacks? They just took wings and flew?
Bye. Actually, we left him at the altar then.
You look great.
Thank you. You have no idea the echo effect it has had on people's lives. I have friends in New Jersey who, Steve Whitehead, I met him, and he has like helped me with learning some videos. I've been able to send them to New Jersey. My mother is a counselor, and she puts them in a small TV, and the people she counsels, we sit in chairs. She has people up sitting in front of this TV, becoming Christians, getting their lives changed. It's unbelievable what these videos have done.
Your mother's a counselor.
Mm-hmm.
She puts on videos.
She has a spiritual hospital that she has been, I don't know, whatever, that people come and when they started, they didn't quite have a thing, so they just played Brownsville videos over and over, and people would sit and watch those for healing.
So are you sleeping good at night now?
Most nights, yeah. I still have a 20-month-old, so. But my 20-month-old learned Mama, Dada, Jesus. And he'll walk around going, Gia, Gia. I mean, it's amazing.
How long has it been now?
Since October, so about 5 or 6 months.
God bless you, girl. Isn't that wonderful? That's wonderful. God bless you. Hi.
My name's Joe Kelly, and I attend the School of Ministry, and I'm originally from Ocean City, Maryland. And I want to share a testimony. This past June, I was at my home church, and I had applied to the school. And I was at church on a Sunday morning, and God began to speak to me and began to deal with me. And I went to the altar, and I got on my face before God and said, God, what is it that you want to tell me? And God spoke to my heart, Guadalajara, Mexico. I said, God, what do you mean? I didn't get an answer, and I laid there, and I prayed, and I prayed, and I prayed, and I said, God, what about it? And I didn't get an answer. I left church that day. I went to a friend's house, and I looked at a map. I had no idea where Guadalajara was or what Guadalajara was all about. And as I looked at the map, I began to pray for the people and began to pray for the city and said, God, please reveal it to me. I came to school here, and the very first week I was in school, they announced they were taking a trip to Guadalajara, Mexico. And God said, now you know what Guadalajara is about. So I applied to go on the trip with Dr. Peters and Miss Toby. And I signed up and was prepared to go, and I really didn't know what to expect. And we went on this trip. And this is just a testimony about God and about the Brownsville Revival. We went to a foreign country, and very few of us spoke English. And we went into churches, church after church after church. And we didn't know the language. We didn't know the culture. But we had one thing in common, and that was the love of Jesus Christ. And I'm just here to tell everybody today that this revival is not about Brownsville. This revival is about the work of God. And as we traveled through the country, and we spent 3 days on a bus, and as we pulled into different churches, some churches who never experienced the move of God, and we went in, we began to worship, and we began to pray. And these people have never experienced God. They've never been slain in the Spirit. They've never had God touch them. And to watch the power of God fall in a church and watch souls be radically saved and to watch people's lives become radically changed and people just lay out and cry out for God. And I guess my testimony is that this revival, this church, this school is about touching the nation, all the nations of the world. And God radically changed my life. And I preached one night, and when I was done, God asked me a simple question. Will you take my message to the nations? And my answer to him is absolutely. The Brownsville Revival is touching the world. The School of Ministry is going out to nations around the world. And the power of God is coming down. And souls are being saved. And lives are being changed. Do not let this revival stay in this church. Do not let this revival stay within you. God has said, deliver it. Give it out. I shouldn't preach. But if God touches your heart and he touches your soul here, don't you dare keep it to yourself, because the world is dying and the world needs to hear it. And the world is going to hear it. And we have a choice to be a part of it or not. This revival has changed my life. This revival has given me a desire. I do not care about myself. It's about the lost souls and the lost people. Thank you.
My name is Sheila Cesario, and I'm from Pueblo, Colorado. I've been saved since I was in my early 30s, and I'm a little older now. So we'd been hearing these are the last days, and the gates of hell weren't supposed to prevail against the church, and I kept looking around saying, God, where's your power? I don't see anybody empowered. So a group of our young teenagers were coming to Brownsville. They'd been one time before, and they needed chaperones, and so I'd like to go. So I just wound up coming, had no idea what was here, didn't really much care, just told the Lord, I want to draw close to you, and I don't seem to be drawing close to you. And the first night when I got here, I was a little judgmental. And that next morning in intercession in Lila's class, I just broke. The whole intercession broke, and we all used half a box of Kleenex. And as soon as that happened, God just supernaturally inserted, like you do the cassette in your VCR recorder to play, he inserted in the five of us ladies that came down with the kids, intercession. We walked in. I wasn't able to pray longer than 15 minutes and didn't see why I would want to. We walked out of here and can pray for hours and love to. And out of that came our children started coming in. There was a move began in our church. Our church isn't in full revival, but you know Colorado's going. We were there that night. Y'all came to Denver and the explosion took place in the heavenlies. But one of the things that happened is I'm the funny lady at our church, and so the Lord has a real sense of humor, because before I came, I looked around our pastor, all the pastors across the United States were praying if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray, and he took it in sections, and so it was on humbling yourself. And I thought, oh, how do you humble yourself? And I thought, well, I could bow, but I don't see anybody bowing, and they're going to think I look funny. Well, you know what my manifestation was. I missed the whole service. I was bowed over the whole time I was here. And we flew home, and we stopped in Houston, and as soon as I got out of the plane, I was bowed and in a squat position all the way through Houston Airport. People thought I was a handicap, but I was just grinning, you know. I was looking for the handicap van, though, because that's a big airport, and I wasn't in great shape. I said, I'm going to have great thighs. So we get to Colorado Springs and get out of the airplane, and again, I'm down and over. So we get home to my daughter's house, and she takes one look at me and said, I'm driving you home, and my husband's sort of real reserved, as wild as I am. He's reserved, you know, smart and reserved.
Your husband?
Yeah. So anyway, I come in and I'm over, you know, demonstration.
What he, yeah. Yeah. And so what he thought? You thought you hurt your back?
His eyes were open wide, let me tell you. But what was playing in my mind the whole time this was going on, this is about 2 years ago when Michael Ratliff was here, was the bride is in Brownsville and she's adorned with her jewels. And every time that would play in my mind, I would go over and bow. And it was like I was bringing home a message and I had the burden on my back. And we noticed in Bobby Gladstone's tape about a year ago or so where he married Brownsville and the Lord. And that was just what I was, one of the things I was so impressed about while I was here. Well, we were in shock. We were just like, duh. We didn't know anything. Didn't know you could have a relationship with the Lord. Didn't know that you could love him with all your heart. We were just transformed. It was like we'd been asleep or dead, even though we were born again and spirit-filled. We just didn't have a clue what was going on. So we have a good group of ladies. One lady is a bag lady, and she's not a real bag lady, but we call her the bag lady because she carries all the videos. You know, we copy them and get them out. She passes them out.
No. She's a bag lady.
Yeah, she's our bag lady. But when Michael Ratliff was here, that...
You know, all of our ladies here at Brownsville are bag ladies, Brownsville Assembly of God, BAG, bag ladies.
I didn't know that. Good. Well, we fit right in. So when he was here that day, I didn't even know there were any prophets, you know, but when you got up that Sunday, it was so holy in here, and just so, everybody says awesome, but it was just so holy in here, and I thought, you know, we can have this at home. And you talked about Esther and how that she made herself beautiful, that she was in the anointing, made herself beautiful, and when she raised her veil, that the king would just, I can preach the sermon almost, I won't, but we were just so radically differently changed, and I'm so thankful. And as I saw the Brownsville people that Sunday, I was so impressed how that every person had a job, and it just seemed like they flowed, and they facilitated. Y'all are up there on the podium, and we honor you greatly, but each person facilitates the revival, and I said, we can really learn for these people. When it breaks out at home, we'll know that we can fit in place. But we've had the best time of our lives, and I always had a good time, but whew, we just... What a good time we're having.
You and this lady here on the front row would make a great evangelist. Y'all would make a great evangelistic couple going out traveling.
Okay, yeah. We'll go.
Hi.
My name is Jennifer, and I'm from Clearwater. I don't even know where to start. I lived with an abusive man for 12 years, my stepfather. I've never known my real father. He abused my mother, my sister, and I every way, shape, and form. When I graduated high school, I started my own job. It wasn't long before I was getting high every day, every other weekend going to Ybor City and not remembering what happened in the morning. Anyway, I came up here. My mom was saved here in September and prayed me here. I got here. Mm-hmm. No, September the year before. I got saved, 98, January. I didn't really understand what was going on, but I loved it. I just, oh, pulled my heart. I loved it. And I came down to the altar, and I got saved, and I went back home to Clearwater. And I'd never been to church, so I didn't really understand what they were talking about. Something agreed in my spirit, but I didn't understand the entire thing. I wasn't long being in Clearwater, not around Christian people, and being 2 hours away from where my mother and an on-fire church was, that my friends talking to me, and they're brainwashing you, you know, all this. I was talked into going back out to Ybor one more night. I didn't drink that night, though, but I went out there, and the Lord opened my eyes, and the things that I saw hanging around in those clubs. I have such a burden for teenagers now and youth. Oh man, I was just watching these little girls and these boys in these clubs, and they're lost. They're just looking for something, and the only thing they can find is to get high and just drift off somewhere to forget about themselves. Oh, geez. In February, I was scheduled to come up here and be baptized.
So you knew you didn't belong in those clubs anymore.
Yes, I knew then. But again, I wasn't in the Word every day, and so for some reason, I didn't want to come back up here. I was like, I don't want to go back up there. I don't want to go back up there.
Why?
I don't know. I had something, you know, you don't need to go up there. You're fine, you know. Yeah, right. Anyway, I came up here in February, and... before the night to come up, it started raining really bad in Clearwater. And raining, you couldn't see 4 feet in front of you, and it never rains like that in Clearwater. It was raining bad. The roads were flooded. And, you know, I called my mom, and I'm like, you know, I can't go. You're just going to have to go without me, you know. And I knew of a big party that weekend that I wanted to go to, and so I figured, you know. Anyway, so she kind of said, well, I want you to pray, and I want you to be serious, and I want you to pray, and I want you to open your Bible. And I prayed, and I just said, Lord, if you want me to go, you know, just make the rain stop. And I mean, immediately it stopped. The roads were clear. I got in my car, and I drove 2 hours to my mother's house, and then we drove 6.5 hours up here. And I was in that back room, and the two people that were teaching the baptismal class, I just saw them, wherever they are. I don't know where they are, but yes, oh, man, I walked in that room and I was just like, all right, I'm going to get baptized. You know, half of me wanted to be there and the other half was screaming. I mean, screaming. I could feel myself. And I was sitting in that room and she's got on this board all these sins written, you know, and she says, when you accept Jesus as your Savior and you ask him to cleanse you, he just, it's like an eraser and he just takes it and he wipes it clean. He doesn't remember it anymore like it was never there. And she asked somebody that was sitting in the class to come up and erase the board and the woman couldn't do it. She broke down and I'm sitting there and all of a sudden the Holy Spirit just started talking to me and he's going, the Lord's here tonight to see you baptized and you're goofing off and you're not taking me seriously. Oh man, I was just, oh, I got up in that back room and I was so excited. I was like, Lord, oh, I'm giving you everything I have. Oh, all I want is you. I, you know, I don't care if I'm poor and I live in some third world country as long as I'm talking about you and, you know, we can all run around like maniacs and praise the Lord. That's, you know, I don't care. And so I got up there and I was baptized. They had to carry me out of the pool. When I was up here, the Lord spoke to me and told me that I'd be going to the school of ministry, and I didn't believe him.
Did you ask for him to rain again? Stop the rain?
No, I want him to rain. Jesus.
So what about school of ministry?
Yeah, he told me I was going to go to the school, and I'm like, yeah, right. You know, I moved out of Clearwater, moved up with my mom, and because I had to get out of that area. I wouldn't last very long there. Bringing my Bible to work every day, people were starting to freak out. It was pretty funny. Witnessing to customers, you know, it was awesome. Anyway,
where'd you work?
At a bathing suit store, actually, in the mall.
I can understand that.
Yeah, it was a hard time. Anyway, I'd been going to an on-fire church, only about 30 of us at this church, but I mean, oh, most on-fire church I've ever. Whew, you know, in this big area, I mean, he's here, you know, but even in with two people, three people, you know, you can feel him and he's so intimate with you. So I've been going to this church and then he's telling me, you're going to go to the school, prepare to go to the school. And every time I would go shopping for anything, do I need that to go to school? It was incredible. It was driving me crazy. And I'm like, I don't have the money. I don't have the means. I have no place to stay. What are you talking about? 3 days ago, I found out I was accepted and I quit my job. And the money was available, and now I have a place to stay. And I registered today, and I start on Tuesday. So,
he has fire in his eyes and a sword in his hand. He's riding a white horse across this land. He has fire in his eyes, a sword in his hand. He's riding a white horse across this land. He's calling out to you and I, will you ride with me? He has fire in his eyes, a sword in his hand. He's riding a white horse across this land. He's calling out to you and me, will you ride with me? Will you ride with me? Yes, Lord, we'll ride. We say, yes, Lord, we will stand up and fight.
We will rise.
With the armies of heaven, we'll be dressed in white.
We'll be dressed in white.
We say, yes, Lord. We'll ride with you. Oh, there's a crown on his head, and he carries a scepter in his hand. He's leading the armies all across this land. And he's calling out to you and me, will you ride with me? Will you ride with me? Fire in his eyes, and it's his love for his bride. He's longing that she be with him right by his side. That fire in his eyes is his burning desire that his bride be with him right by his side. He's calling out to us tonight, will you ride with me? Lift up your hand if your answer is yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes,
I want everyone to stand. Those of you at home, stand to your feet. We're going to pray and ask the Lord to speak to our hearts and change our lives. Now, when we pray this prayer, look this way and listen. Don't let the devil steal one word tonight from you. God wants to speak to you. When we pray, Jesus, speak to my heart, change my life. I don't know if you've been listening to some of these testimonies, but when you pray a prayer like that, he can change everything about your life. He can change your location. He can change your position. He can change the vices and the bondages that you're in. He can change everything. He can take you out of your spiritual, your depression that you're in right now. He can take you out of your dry time. When you pray, Jesus, speak to my heart, change my life, he can change everything. How many believe that? We're going to pray that prayer tonight. I want those of you that are listening by internet, I want you to pray. Those of you on radio and those of you watching at home, I want you to pray this prayer. We're going to pray, speak to my heart, Jesus, and change my life. And my message tonight, I know, is for tonight. 3 points, that's it. Just 3 points for this Saturday night, and God's going to touch you. God's going to speak. Everyone pray right now. Dear Jesus. Now I want everyone to pray, everyone together. Dear Jesus, speak to my heart, change my life. In your precious name, amen. You may be seated. I love testimonies. I don't like testifonies, but I love testimonies. Real stuff happening to real people. Last Wednesday night, I began preaching a sermon entitled The Crusade of the Christ Child. How many were not here last Wednesday night? Lift your hand if you were not here. Lift it high. Almost everybody. I started to preach a message entitled The Crusade of the Christ Child. And if you were here, you might remember me mentioning the definition of crusade. A crusade is any vigorous, concerted movement for a cause. It is a campaign undertaken with zeal and enthusiasm. And I talked about the life of Jesus being a crusade. How many would agree with me that Jesus took on his life with zeal and enthusiasm? It was a crusade. And I talked to you last Wednesday about the crusades that we hold around the nation and around the world. When I go into an area like Argentina or Russia or Spain, wherever we go to succeed. I do never set out to plant a church anywhere in the world to fail. I set out to succeed. Jesus, when he was sent by God, you remember some of the first words that were said about him by John the Baptist when Jesus was beginning his ministry. Behold, the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world. That's a successful statement, friend. And when we would set out to plant a church, we would go into an area and we would call it a crusade. Those of you from Latin America, Cruzada, we'd go in and we'd put out flyers all over the city. We'd knock on doors. We'd put them on automobiles. If it's an underprivileged nation, a third world nation, we'd give them to people riding by on horseback and people on the streets and inviting everyone to an evening service. Sometimes we'd set up a tent. Other times we'd do it in an auditorium, sometimes just in the open air. But everywhere we went, our hearts were just beating like this. And every time I handed a flyer to somebody and I said, I want you to come, I'm going to be preaching tonight in the center of town under that big tent. I'd say, have you seen the tent? They'll go. I said, I want you to be there. You're my special guest. And there was nothing like it in the world to arrive that night and see these people coming from all over the city. Many of them not toting Bibles because they weren't even saved. They had no clue what was about to go on. All they heard was that there was going to be a miracle service under that big yellow and white tent. That was a crusade. And I shared on Wednesday night, and I'm not going to go through all the details of our church planting work, but I talked to you about the details of it and how everything was geared towards success. And it was done with zeal and enthusiasm. So was the life of Jesus. On Wednesday night, I talked about the first recorded words of Jesus. Many of you know the story how he was 12 years old and he slipped away from his mom and dad and he was in the temple discussing with the doctors. This boy at age 12 was baffling, bewildering members of the clergy. People that were in the church could not believe the wisdom this young man had, but he had left his mom and dad and his mom and dad came to find him, and when they approached him, he said, did you not know that I must be about my father's business? And I said to you, that was like the first bookend of Jesus's life. That's when he really started. Now there was years that went by, 19 years, something like that, 18, 19 years before he actually started his ministry. But that right there was a statement. How many do you, 12-year-old kids here, would make that kind of statement, that you're that serious about life? That you would go to your friends and say, I don't know about you, I like Legos and I like skateboards and I like bicycles and I like watching good videos and all, but I don't know about you, but I'm going to be about my father's business. I'm going to be a preacher. I'm going to share the gospel. Your heart, it's hard. You'll be hard pressed to find kids that'll talk like that. But Jesus, and I know through revival, many of them are talking like that now. Many kids are getting the burden of the Lord and beginning to get serious about life at an early age. But here Jesus says, I must be about my father's business. And then I read a scripture from Matthew 18. And Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. That was the other bookend. The beginning in the temple, and now here he is at the end of his life. It was a successful crusade. Are you hearing me tonight? We talked about 3 points. That's all I got to on Wednesday night. One was this, about the crusade of the Christ child. It was marked by submission. These were all S words. And by the way, I'm not preaching this message tonight. God's got us going in a different direction. I don't know when I'll complete this. But I talked about the crusade of the Christ child was marked by submission. When he was 12, look this way, folks. When he was 12, he submitted himself to his mom and his dad. He came under their authority. And I talked to you on Wednesday night that all through the Lord's life, he was always saying things like this, I must do the will of my Father. What my Father tells me to do, that's what I will do. He did not have a will of his own. And let me tell you, if you're bought with a price, if you're a Christian, you don't have a choice anymore. You are subjected to Jesus Christ. When we say Jesus, you're Lord, that means you're the governor. You're over me. You call the shots. Then I talked about the crusade of Christ the child. Christ's child was marked by servanthood. Everywhere he went, he served. And I brought out the scripture when Jesus was washing the disciples' feet. Right before he washed the disciples' feet. This is a powerful text. The Bible says right before he did it, he did that because he knew where he came from and he knew where he was going. He got down on his knees and began to wash their feet. That's the key to servanthood. See, a lot of people can't be servants because they don't know where they've come from and they don't know where they're going. And so they're prideful. They're concerned about what other people are going to think about them. They're wondering how Sheila's going to think, or Bob's going to think, or my friends are going to think about me. Jennifer just shared a few minutes ago about witnessing to her friends in Clearwater at a bathing suit store, talking to them about God, bringing her Bible there. And I want to tell you, when you start doing that and you do it with fervency, your time is limited. But why would she do that? Because she knew where she came from, she knew where she was going. You become stable in that. You become a servant of the Lord. And she said, she made another statement tonight. She said, I don't care where I end up. It can be in a third world country, just hoofing it, working the streets in a third world country, talking to people about Jesus. I don't care. See, that's the life of a servant. And Jesus' life was like that. He knew where he came from. He knew where he was going, so it didn't matter what happened in the middle. Some of you have a real problem with this. But this is a crusade of the Christ child. And by the way, everyone within the sound of my voice, if you're going to call yourself a Christian, you need to line up with these characteristics in the life of Christ. One other thing that I shared on Wednesday night was a crusade of the Christ child was marked by seriousness. Say seriousness. He wasn't giddy. He wasn't joking. He was serious all the way through. Now, I know he had a great time with his disciples, and we talked about that a little bit. You know, the scriptures, John said, of all the things Jesus did were written down, the world couldn't contain the books. And I promise you, friend, all the junk that went on between he and those disciples could be a comedy book. I know, because just the stuff we read brings me to tears laughing when I read about Peter and some of the things that went on, the jokes, the life that Jesus had with his disciples behind the scene. That's the only way he could have drawn them so close, by being a friend with them, joking, having a good time with them. But when it came time to the gospel, when it came time to preach, when it came time to talk about heaven and hell, Jesus was serious. Is anybody with me tonight? His life was marked with seriousness. This was a crusade of the Christ child. He was always headed towards Jerusalem. He was always going to the cross, and he would turn to his disciples in the midst of miracles, signs, and wonders, and he would say things like, I've got to go up because the Son of Man is going to be handed over, and he's going to be killed, he's going to be crucified, and the third day he's going to rise again. He was always saying things like that, serious. They were like shock treatments to the disciples. Well, about that time on Wednesday night as I was preaching, you could feel the conviction in this place. I could feel it, literally feel it. And I didn't have to preach the message, the rest of the message. I could feel that the work was done. The arrows had hit the target, and I wasn't even halfway through the message. And I gave the altar call, and the altar's flooded with people weeping and wailing. And at the end of it, several people came up to me and said, Brother Steve, I have got such a problem with submission. Another person came up to me and said, I need God to help me to be serious about life. I'm not serious about life. And another person came up and started talking to me about servanthood. God had hit the mark that night. He does every night at the Brownsville Revival. He knows who you are. He knows why you're here. But tonight I feel as there's a need to put an emphasis on something, an area that was touched on Wednesday night. I want you to turn with me to the book of Philippians. The book of Philippians. Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians. J. General Electric Power Company, Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians. For the Jewish people here, the Messianic Jews, Gentiles eat pork chops. Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians. Philippians 2. A familiar scripture that people read as if there's nothing there. 7 and 8, chapter 2, verse 7 and 8. But he made himself of no reputation and took upon him the form of a servant and was made in the likeness of men. And being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. There's two of my points right there, servanthood and submission. Wherefore God also has highly exalted him and given him a name above, which is above every name, that the name of Jesus every knee should bow of things in heaven and things in earth and things under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Here's what we're going to talk about for a few minutes. And those of you here that do not know the Lord, you're going to get saved tonight, but you're going to get saved right. All right? I'm sick of people getting saved wrong. It's really, you can't use that terminology because they're not getting saved, period. But they come forward to the altar because they feel bad over something they've done. And they want to get that junk off of them, so they ask Jesus to wash them clean. And they go through an act of repentance, but they really don't have an understanding of what they're doing. They really don't have an understanding. When you give your life to Jesus, you give your life to Jesus, friend. You don't get up and go out and say, well, I'm going to continue on with what I was doing. No, sir. When you leave out of this place, you say, Jesus, what would you have me to do? Before I came into Brownsville, I was an engineer at IBM. Now, do you still want me to be at IBM? Before I came here, I was a teacher in the public school system. Do you still want me to do that? Before I came here, and the list goes on and on, you start asking questions. Before I came here, I was a drug addict. Now I'm a Christian. You walk out that door, you say, Jesus, what about these drugs? Everything begins to change. Is anybody listening? Some of you are going through major changes right now because God is turning you and twisting you and dropping things in your head, like go to the Brownsville Revival School of Ministry. And you're going, how? I'm broke. How? My family will never understand. How do you, why? I'm from Pennsylvania, God. I can't go all the way down to Florida and live. I'm a home person. I love to be around my family. But God is twisting you and he's turning you. He's changing you. And this is what we're going to spend a little time on tonight. This is entitled, The Death of Mr. Me. The Death of Mr. Me. And to just give you a little atmosphere, let's see if we can pull up a little funeral music here. Is that morbid enough? Here I go to Brownsville. Whoever wrote this song was a sick, sick person, friend. I listened to this all the way through the other day and could not believe how sad this song is. You couldn't write a sadder song. Can't you just see the casket going down? Death of Mr. Me. Well, we'll pull that down for a little. We might pull that up in a minute, Jeff. Everybody all right? All right? Don't get morbid on me now. The death of Mr. Me. You're going to understand before we're finished. In a few minutes, Charity's going to sing Mercy Seat. You're going to understand that when you become a Christian, you die. You die. You are no longer your own. And we are to follow the model of Jesus Christ, when he said, "Yes, Father, I'll go down," he was saying, "Yes, Father, I will die." He took of himself no reputation. He emptied himself, came down to earth, put on the cloak of flesh and blood, walked for 33 and a half years on the face of this globe after leaving the glories of heaven. You think you've left something, friend? You ain't left nothing. Jesus left it all to get down around people that were spitting. What do you think it's like in heaven? What do you think the angels look like? What do you think the talk is like up there? What do you think? I mean, friend, he comes down here and people smell. They stink. Do you think it stinks in heaven? Can you imagine the first time Jesus smelled some of that stuff? Just B.O. and all going. He had never been around that, friend. He's from heaven. How many would believe that it's sweet up there? He emptied himself, friend. Everything was wonderful. Fellowship. He didn't walk in heaven. You don't walk around hearing GD this and GD that. You don't hear cussing up there. You don't see nudity up there. You don't see wild parties up here. You don't see people murdered. You don't see incest. You don't see abortions. But then he comes down here and he sees people raping. He sees people killing. He sees filth. And he stays. Well, let me just give you a few points tonight. As a matter of fact, turn that back on, Jeff. Just bring it up just a little bit. The death of Mr. Me. Turn it up, brother. You got a knob on there? Louder. Louder. Come live for Jesus. A life full of joy. Hope. Number one. Stay by that knob. I like that song. It's growing on me now. We need to weave that into the Brownsville CD. If you're going to be a Christian, number one, the death of Mr. Me is certain. If you're going to be a Christian, the death of Mr. Me is certain. Say certain. C-E-R-T-A-I-N. Certain. When people come up to me and go, "Brother Steve, you're not going to believe what's happened to me," and they give me some sob story, I just stand there and look at them like, well, that's the way it is. My parents don't love me anymore. Why? Because you've given your life to Jesus. Now you're on fire for God. And they expect me to fall on my face and moan and groan and cry. And I'm going, that sounds like the Christian life. When I got saved, my sister cussed me out. Before, I could go into her house and I can cuss, I could drink, I could party with her. And now I got saved. And I went over to her house and I went, "Praise the Lord, Marcia." She said, "What'd you say?" I said, "Praise the Lord." She said, "Don't you ever use that language in my house again." So people come to me and they tell me all these horrid stories about what it's like now. All my friends have left me. Well, you're beginning to die. Death is certain. Say certain. Now, Matthew 16:24 says this, "If any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me." Say, deny himself. Friend, that means everything. That means your ambitions, your goals. And I'm going to get into this in just a minute, and then we're going to close this service because you're going to understand it. It will be clear tonight. Those of you that have aspirations, you have dreams and desires, get ready for God to take them all down and let him build his kingdom. There is only one kingdom. It is God's kingdom. Matthew 16:24 said that. And if you don't like that scripture, you can turn to Mark 8:34. "Whosoever will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me." If you don't like that one, turn to Luke 9:23. "If any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me." What part of that do you not understand, friend? You're denying yourself. You're laying yourself down. If you're going to be a Christian, you are certain to die. To go after a self-denying Christ is impossible without the denial of self. I'm going to say that again. To go after a self-denying Christ is impossible without the denial of self. Because if you're going to follow in his footsteps, his life, his very life was marked from the cradle to the grave with self-denial. We must deny our own thoughts, our will, our power, our interests, everything that could hinder his will, his power, and his interests from being accomplished in us and by us. Are you listening, friend? Paul in Romans 6, and I'm not going to read all this, but you read 2 through 11. He said, know ye not that so many of us were baptized into Jesus Christ, were baptized unto his death. Therefore, we are buried with him by baptism unto death. Friend, the Christian life is one of constant self-denial. Trying to paint you an honest picture. If you ever hear an evangelist stand up and say, you live for Jesus and everything will go be rosy, everything will be wonderful, you need to get out of that church as quick as you can. That ain't the way it is, friend. The moment I got saved, I found out real quick that things were not going to go my way. But as I endured, I saw that this is the best way. And like D.L. Moody said, God has taken me places I could have never gone myself. I look at it now and I say, I've been around the world. I've preached the gospel everywhere. I'm privileged to be at the Brownsville Revival to participate in this thing. I'm going, God has taken me places I could have never gone myself. And I want to tell you why, friend. It's called self-denial. Let me put it in layman's terms. I used to work in a program called Teen Challenge. And Jerry, you remember how much money we made back then? $125 every 2 weeks, $60 a week between us. Say that's not a lot of money. That's the truth. It is not a lot of money, friend. We didn't have any money for nothing. We lived broke, okay? Just... And then when you tithe off 120, you know, that's 12 bucks, man. You're already broke. And so that's how much money we made. We were thrilled. We were happy. We lived in a house that was interesting. The other day, Jerry went out and bought some goldfish. And for our kids, my kids got three little aquariums, and she bought some goldfish for them. And I remembered when you went and did that just the other day. Remember the time we came home from church or somewhere? We'd been gone for a few days, and our house had no heat, okay? And we came home, it was wintertime. We had an aquarium, too. And the fish were froze. They just... And people would come over to our house... And you could feel it, you know. I'm not complaining. It's just the way it was, friend. But I would go out early in the morning. I knew the route of the garbage trucks in the wealthy area of the cities. And early in the morning on garbage day, I'd take my pickup truck. I had a little Datsun pickup truck, a little orange pickup truck, Brownsville Revival School of Ministry colors. And I would take, my orange pickup truck, and I'd go through the poor areas of town. And the rich areas of town, and I'd find out what they were throwing away. Because, you know, rich people, a leg breaks off a chair, they throw the whole chair away. And so I'd pick up old chairs and pieces of carpet with big chunks out of it, you know, and bring it back home. And our house looked fine as long as you didn't look. But if you investigated, you'd pick up the sofa and there was no carpet. There was a big square of carpet missing underneath it because we'd put the sofa over the hole. And I remember people would come over to our house and the expression on their face was, then no one ever wanted to come over to eat, you know, or anything like that. But they'd come over and visit, you know, every now and then, and they'd always recommend, let's go to a restaurant or something else. And we had roaches. And we had rats. I would come in at night, and Jerry would wait out on the front steps. Everybody needs stories like this, by the way. If you've got a newlywed couple coming up, you need to move them into the slum somewhere so they have some stories. But we would come home from church, and I'd get on the front step. Everything was wood. And I'd say, Jerry, wait outside. And I'd go in. I'd turn the lights on. I'd go, ah! And I'd watch thousands of roaches scatter. There was no getting rid of them. They'd been living there 95 years. And we had rats. We'd go to sleep at night and we'd lay our head on the pillow and you could hear them. They would wait, you know, till we go to sleep. And when I lay there and you could hear them scamper across, and then you'd hear macaroni fall to the ground or something like that. I remember one time sitting down in the living in the kitchen with a BB gun all night long. Just, and some of you are thinking, why didn't you use roach tablets? Why didn't, friend, they ate those things like M&Ms. There was nothing gonna stop this. But I remember in the midst of our luxurious lifestyle, a phone call from a wealthy church. And this is what he said. Is this Stephen Hill? I said, yes. Reverend Stephen Hill? I said, yeah. They said, we're in need of an associate pastor. And they named the city they're from. And that, as soon as they named the city, my eyes just lit up, a major city. And they named the neighborhood of that city. And he said this. He said, our neighborhood is the wealthiest in the city. We want you to come be our associate. And he gave me my salary over the phone. And he said, we will give you this amount. And friend, it was a zillion times more than what we were making. It was unbelievable. It would be a great salary today. And this was back in the 70s. And he said, we'll give you a car and a house on top of that if you'll come and be our associate. And here we were, $120 or $60 a week. And I put the phone down and I said, Jesus. No. Okay. No. Called him back. I said, I'm sorry. It's not God's will for our lives. You want to know why? Because early on, I'd heard learn something about denial. I learned something about denying self and this junk that starts trapping you. And if I had gone there, I probably wouldn't be at the Brownsville Revival today. My life would have taken a whole different direction. A whole different direction. But I heard from God that day. And God said, no, this is where I have you. And from that place, God has led me. And it took 20 years. God led us to Brownsville. Is anybody listening? Leonard Ravenhill. Leonard Ravenhill said this in his book, Meat for Men. He said, if any man wants to write a bestseller, he could write a book entitled How to Be a Saint in 6 Easy Lessons. Such a writer would be fishing with bait that this generation of believers wants, but I, for one, would not swallow it. When we sing in a sunlit church, oh, to be like thee, to be like Jesus, to be like Jesus, all I want to be like you, to be like, you know that song? We get all weepy and we feel an emotional lift. But he says, permit me to challenge you with this. Do you really mean to be like Jesus? Like the Christ of God, who is a man of discipline? Say discipline. Do we really mean to be like Jesus, fasting alone in the desert? Do we mean to be like Jesus so that without our wilting under it, the world can say of us, of him, he has a devil? Here's a man of God and they call him demon possessed. What would you do if somebody called you demon possessed? Some of you Brownsville Revival School of Ministry students would well up. You'd get all ticked and mad. They call Jesus a devil. Do we mean, oh, to be like Jesus? Are we willing to touch the depths of prayer that he did? to be like Jesus? Are you willing to spend time in the intercessor's chamber to be like Jesus? Are you willing to do the will of God? I want to tell you, friend, if you're going to be a Christian, the death of Mr. Me is certain. I got a book that Leonard Ravenhill gave me called Scriptural Death Route Holiness. Scriptural Death Route Holiness. I remember when he gave it to me, I thought, what on earth is this? Death Route Holiness. You got that back there? I felt like this when I saw the title. Scriptural Death Route Holiness. Grows on you, doesn't it? A great majority of professed Christians, when coming face to face with their own carnal state and their own execution, have backed down and sought out an easier way. A great deal of Christians, he's saying, when they're faced with the fact that they are going to the gallows, they are the ones that are going to be crucified with Christ, they back down and they choose just to be a choir member, or just to be a deacon, or just to do this, not to commit themselves to Christ, but to commit themselves to some source, some area of religion. I remember when I was a brand new Christian, there was a group called Dogwood, and they had a song called The Water Grave, and he said, I'm going down to the river, I'm going to be buried alive, I'm going to show my heavenly Father that the man I used to be has finally died. And I remember hearing that song, and I thought, that is so cool. That is so real. Because the old Steve Hill is dead and gone. If you're going to be a Christian, friend, the death of Mr. Me is certain. Number two, if you're going to be a Christian, the death of Mr. Me is going to be painful. Say painful. If you're going to be a Christian, the death of Mr. Me is going to be painful. Crucifixion is painful. Hello. It takes time to die on the cross. That's why Paul said, in Christ Jesus our Lord, in 1 Corinthians 15:31, I die daily. How many have noticed that that little creep keeps crawling off out of the casket or off the cross? You notice that? And you have to die daily to your desires, your dreams. Some of you that are coming here for the school, you're on fire now. But I want to see in about 2 months. In about 2 months, I'm going to hear a creaky casket. And you're going to start rising up in that casket. And you're going to turn the mic. You can just say, I'm getting out of here. I just thought I wanted to die. Why? Because it's exam time. And Bob Gladstone is coming down heavy this semester. It's going to be painful. It's a life of self-denial. That is painful. You want to, I think I need to just stay on simple illustrations tonight. Let me share something that's painful to you. When you are in love with somebody, you fall in love with somebody, and you're dating for 6 months, and this man, who is 6'3", authoritative, comes over to you while you're with your girlfriend in the hallway of the church. He comes up just in passing. He says, excuse me, I'd like for you to set up an appointment with me. And you go, okay, fine, we'll call Rose, his secretary. And you're thinking, he's gonna bless our union. He's going to tell us that he heard from God and this is him. This is the Lord. God's put us together. And then you come to the meeting and he pulls you in by yourself and leaves a little lady out in the hallway. And he says this to you. What's your name? You say, John. And he says, who do you think you are? I saw your hand on that woman. I saw you caressing her. I saw you lusting in this church. I saw you with eyes on other women before you had your eyes on this woman. I'm the pastor of this church. These are my sheep. If you're going to date this girl, you're not going to date her right now. You're going on 1 year's probation. And if it's God, in 1 year, we'll talk again. You know what that is, friend? You walk out of his office, she goes, how did it go? It's going to be painful, friend. Is anybody understanding this, or I'm the only one understanding? This is your Christian life. I remember, I only got one more point after this, friend. I remember when my wife and I were going to be missionaries with the Assemblies of God. We were so excited. We were ready to take on the world. We were ignited. We had already been to Argentina, and God was mightily using us. I was God's man for the hour, friend. I mean, I was just ready, Freddy. It was going to happen through me. Okay? So we go up to Springfield, and they were excited about us. They were excited that these two young whippersnappers were going to go, you know, reach out into the highways and the byways. And, you know, they were a little concerned about us because we're ex-dopers, you know. We were both acid freaks, you know, and so they made us sit down with psychiatrists and psychologists, and I've told this story before, friend, but I got to tell it again. I sat in front of a psychiatrist, and you know, I'd been under quack, so, excuse me, psychiatrist. Forgive me. I've been under psychiatrist before on drugs, and it was just all, you know, just stuff. And so here's this guy, and I'm sitting down in his room. My wife's sitting outside waiting for her interview. And he sits down, and everybody tells me about this guy, that it's doom, it's over. You know, he's going to see right through you. And so I'm sitting there, and I'm transparent, you know, see through me. And so I'm sitting there, and a fly comes in the room and starts going, bzzz. So I look at this fly, and I watch it fly around the room. And what I didn't fully understand at that point, but he was watching me watch the fly. Assembly God missionary. I was trying to be a missionary with the assemblies. You know, this was an important meeting. And I'm going. And it lands right in front of him. And I went. And I reached my hand up behind the fly, because flies take off backwards and go forward. You'll learn at the Brownsville Revival. So I came up behind him, and I went, whoop, and I went, got him. He looked at me. He said, let me tell you something. He said, the only reason you caught that fly is because this is Missouri, and there's a lot of humidity here. He said, if you had tried to catch that fly in Arizona, you'd have never caught that fly. It'd have been quicker. He said, that was slow, but here the wings are sluggish here in Missouri. And I knew that it was going to be a good interview after that. So I let the fly go, and he did the blot test, you know, the ink blot test. You ever had them things? Everything looks like a bug, a moth. And, you know, they show it to you. And so he shows me one, and he says, what's it look like? I said, a moth. Shows me another one. He says, what's it look like? I said, a moth. He said, what comes to your mind when I show you this one? And I said, a moth. He said, son, you can't see a moth in every one of these. And I said, sir, look at me. I said, I've been on drugs all my life. I have seen everything you want to see. I have hallucinated. I have hallucinated on LSD. I've seen stuff that wasn't there on walls. I've seen it all. I'm telling you, those are moths. Because what they were testing was our stability, you know, and whether or not we can assert ourselves and all. And so he leaves, he gets up, gets the telephone, picks it up, and calls the headquarters. And he said, "I've got Reverend Stephen Hill over here." And he said, "It looks like we have a missionary." He said, and but then we go before a big interview. We wanted to go to Argentina. Say Argentina. The fires of revival. It was awesome. We wanted to go to Argentina. Have you ever had your heart set on something? I'm going to ask that again because some of you have your heart set right now. You ever had your heart set on something? You already have the neighborhood picked out where you're going to live, what kind of car you're going to buy, where you're going to work, everything about it. You already got friends there. We had already been down there a month preaching the gospel, work, and we told everybody we're coming back. Now we're in Springfield, Missouri, sitting around this big Indian table with all these elderly missionaries. Some of them were 670 years old. They'd been... They were there. They had been there. They had done it. And so the head man, J. Philip Hogan, he looks at us and he says, "So you want to go to Argentina?" And here all these seven men are sitting around this table, Jerry and I, just young kids, you know, and we said, "Yes, we want to go to Argentina. God's called us to Argentina." And he said, "Well, we've decided we're going to send you to Africa." Africa! That's as far as night is from day to Argentina, friend. We wanted to go to Buenos Aires, 11 million people, a European city. It's called the Paris of South America. And they were talking canoes. They were talking about riverboats. They were talking about huts out in the middle of the jungles. Spear guns. But I had learned a lesson that crucifixion, and if you're going to live a Christian life, it's going to be painful. And you know what we said to him? We said, "Sure, we'll go to Africa." And he had never heard that from a missionary before. He turned to the rest of them and said, "I don't care, they can go to Argentina." It was a trick. But you want to know what most missionaries do? Most young missionaries, they rise up and they go, "God's called me to Guatemala. Who do you think you folks are to tell me I can't go to Guatemala? I'm going to Guatemala with or without the Assemblies of God." Then they'll say, "Okay, go on. Hasta luego. Ciao. Enjoy. Because you ain't going with the Assemblies because you've got a rebellious heart. You've never learned how to deny yourself. You've never heard how to die to self." Is anybody listening tonight, friend? If you're going to die, the death of Mr. Me is going to be painful. It's going to be things that you don't want to do, you have to do, and things that you cannot believe God's having you do. Things you want to do, you can't do. Things you don't want to do, you have to do. Is anybody with me? Well, I don't know. Hallelujah. You don't get the credit for things when you become a Christian. You're dying to self. It's painful. Well, I wrote down the ABCs of some of the stuff that you leave behind. A, ambitions. B, beliefs. C, carnality. D, desires. E, ego. F, friendships. G, goals. H, habits. I, individualism. J, jealousies. These are all things that you die to. K, kingship. I'm head of my own life. L, liberalism. M, manpower. I can do it myself. I don't need anybody else. N, notoriety. O, opulence. Living a luxurious lifestyle. P, passions. What are the things that you go after now? When you become a Christian, you won't go after them anymore, friend. Q, quirks. When I was going through there, I thought, you know, that is so true. There are things or peculiar characteristics of people that you were known by when you were a worldly person. You know, you were in the bars and they called you a certain name. You know, because you were a jokester or something, and you were the life of the party. When you become a Christian, you die to that. Your silly little quirks. Suddenly, maybe you were a jokester in the bars, but now you're known as the most serious person at the Brownsville Revival School of Ministry. What happened to you? You died to that quirk of yours that made everybody laugh all the time. R, religion, you died to the religion. S, self. T, your temper. Your wife has had a bad day. You've had a bad day. She promised you that when you get home, she would have a char-grilled hamburger waiting for you, but she's had a bad day. You come home, you walk in, you're mad. You're tired, you're hot. You walk in and you don't smell the hamburger, and dishes are piled up to the ceiling, and there's dirt all over the floor, and laundry is everywhere, and your wife is asleep on the couch. There was a time where she would wake up with great vigor because you attacked her and said, "Get in that kitchen and fix me a hamburger." But now, you've died to your temper. And now, you go up to her and say, "Honey, I perceive that things have not gone according to plan today. Baby, would you like a hamburger? I would be glad to fix you a hamburger after I've done the dishes. After I've washed the laundry, after I've vacuumed up the house." Why? Because you died to your temper. You, your understanding, lean not to your own understanding. V, vanity. W, will. You've died to your will. I like this one. X, it was tough finding one for X. Xenophobia, you're dying to your xenophobia. You know what that is? Your fear of strangers and standing in front of people. When you become a Christian, friend, you better start talking to strangers. You better get up and say, "I love the Lord with all my heart, all my soul, and all my strength." Are you telling me I've got to get up in front of people? Come. Take the mic. Talk to them. You got to die, Y, to yourself. And Z, this is another tough one, to zaniness. This is a crazy acting person. Many of you in this room, when you were in the world, you were nuts. You were crazy. You were stupid. You would do things that no one else would do. They would call you, wave at me if that was you. But now that you're a Christian, you're dying to all of that. Well, I'm going to close. Oop. Number three, if you're going to be a Christian, the death of Mr. Me is going to be rewarding. No music. I am crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live. Galatians 2:20. Remember John 10:10? "For I have come," said Jesus, "that they might have life and that they might have it more abundantly." Eternal life with Jesus, friend, think about it. The Bible says, unless a corn of wheat falls to the ground and dies, unless a corn of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it won't bring forth fruit. The life after death is rewarding, friend. Remember the scriptures I read to you, and I'm closing. I talked about denying yourself in Matthew, in Mark, and in Luke. But then Mark says the next scripture, "For so whosoever will lose his life shall," so whosoever will save his life shall lose it, "and whosoever will lose his life for my sake shall find it. Mark 8:35, for whosoever will save his life shall lose it, but whosoever shall lose his life for my sake and the gospel's, the same shall save it. You want to save your life, friend? Then die. Let Mr. Me go to the grave tonight. Luke said, whosoever will save his life shall lose it, but whosoever will lose his life for my sake, the same shall save it. Now, those of you that are taking notes, you'll notice the first one was what? Mr. Death of Mr. Me is? The second one, the death of Mr. Me is? Painful. The death of Mr. Me is? CPR. Okay? Let me tell you what the devil will do. The devil will come up to you and try to give you mouth-to-mouth resuscitation, friend. He'll do everything he can to raise you up. He'll talk to you in that casket. He'll tell you, hey, listen, this really isn't going the way you planned. You came down with Brown to Brownsville with some money. Now you're dead broke. Now you're eating, you know, you're eating from just scraps on the table. You ain't got gas for your car. You're hitchhiking to school. You ain't got books. You're using somebody else's books. He's looking at you saying, listen, you had a whole lot better life before you ever came here. He's a liar. You know what he's doing? He's trying to breathe life into that dead man. Boy, the devil tried to do that all the time in me when I first got saved. I'd have people, I'd lead people to Jesus. I'd be holding a bag of cocaine. And I'd be having a bad day. And I'd lead them to Jesus. And they'd say, well, what am I supposed to do with this? And I'd be looking at a bag of white powder cocaine. And I'd be having a bad day. And the devil would say, take that, have a good day. CPR. Let me bring you back to life, son. But I learned a long time ago, you flush it. You get it out of your sight. You flee every appearance of evil, friend. Don't let the devil come up to you and bring you back to life. Stay dead. Because the resurrected man, that child of God that's walking, breathing, talking now, has got a future that if you knew it, you'd probably drop dead of a heart attack. How beautiful God has his plans for you. How wonderful it's going to be. Just, I don't know what's going to go take place in this earth. I look at this man, E.T. Corbin, right here. He's 87 years old. You got the reddest coat in town tonight, friend. This man, 87 years old. He'll be praying for you tonight, by the way. If you're sick, let this man pray for you. He's got a touch of God on his life for healings. He'll be sitting right there and praying for folks. Here's this man. You've had a wonderful life, haven't you, brother? A great life. 87 ain't over. You hear me now? It ain't over. We're going up together, brother. But he's had a wonderful life. And you know what? He just got a wonderful life, and he gets heaven too. On top of all this, when he does die, it's better. Friend, and the devil will try to talk somebody out of something like that. Living a pure, holy, wonderful life. Think about it, friend. Think about where the disciples are at. Peter, James, and John. All that they went through. Who cares? Man, today they got a mansion in glory. They're helping to prepare the marriage supper of the Lamb. They're up there hanging around the angels. They're up there saying, Jesus, when's that Brownsville revival going to be over? When are you going to wrap this whole thing up? We're ready to start eternity. We're ready to start this, just the blessed, the best of the best. Friend, it's rewarding. But the only way it's going to be rewarding is if you die. Some of you backsliders, the reason your life is so miserable is because you ain't dead. When you die to yourself and rise and let Jesus live through you, then it's going to all come together. Let's stand. Charity, come join me up here one more time. So those of you with the chairs, move them to the left and the right if you would. The death of Mr. Me. Well, let's talk about the Brownsville revival while they move their chairs. In this revival, we die daily. This revival is work. Say work. Some of you that are visiting from other churches, you want God to break out in your church in revival? I had a pastor call me the other day. He'd been in revival for 6 months just on Friday nights. Just on Friday nights. And he's quitting. Why? It's too hard, he said. I said, how are the services going? He said, it's awesome. Awesome. But he said, Steve, it's wearing us out. And I asked him a very pointed question. What else are you going to do on Friday night? You know, most people will trade 3 or 4 hours of revival for 3 or 4 hours of television. That's what they'll go do. Oh, they won't go home and spend family time. And if they do, it'll be in front of a television set. But this is just too difficult, this revival. Friend, you better learn how to die to self. Drag yourself out of bed. Get a hold of the Word of God. Begin reading. You think it's easy? And I'm not patting myself on the back, friend, but getting up every morning, getting a message. It ain't easy, friend. That yesterday when I preached on Samson, I spent the whole day preparing that message, tired all day long, preparing a message to deliver that night. When it's over, it's over. You won't hear me preach on Samson the rest of the revival. Why? Because I don't take messages and keep repeating them over and over again. I put them aside and I want a fresh word from the Lord every single time I preach. So it's work. You deny yourself. The devil oftentimes, when I get up in the morning, he'll say, why don't you just go over there to your archives? You have preached every day since Father's Day, 1995. Just get a sermon and preach it. How many were here in July of 1995? Raise your hand. Oh, 5, 6, 10 people. So why don't I preach the messages from July 1995? What am I doing preaching a new message? God wants me to preach a new message. This is January of 1999. This is not July of 1995. He's got a word he wants to speak. He doesn't want some of you pastors that you just go and pull out of your archives and just grab something and say, Jesus, take these stale leftovers and make something out of it. You better get on your face before God. Don't have a sheet of paper in front of you and say, God, what do you want to say to the people? And if he says, I want you on your face for 7 hours preparing a message, all day today, John Kilpatrick was on his face. I'm telling the truth, all day today in his study, getting ready for tomorrow morning. All day. Why? Friend, he's pastored for years. Why does he have to do that? Why? Because there's going to be thousands of people here that want to hear a word from the Lord. And you deny your flesh. You die to Mr. Me. You open up the Word and you begin digging and writing and studying. Here's what we're going to do tonight. Everyone who needs forgiveness, you're going to come quickly. You're not going to hesitate tonight. You're going to come quickly. If you're in this place and you're away from God, perhaps you're here tonight and you've never known the Lord, I want you to come and taste and see that the Lord is good. Everything I've said tonight, friend, about dying to self, Jesus did. He died to himself. He died to his own fleshly desires. Jesus laid himself down. He laid his life down. He willingly laid it down, the Word says. They didn't take it from him. He laid it down. He gave his life for you, friend, 2,000 years ago, that you might have life tonight. When I give this altar call, if you want Jesus Christ to change your life, you've got to come forward. Why do I have to come forward? There you go again. You can't even die right. It's all part of the death process. Death to what? Pride. Ego. You're going down to the altar, getting right with God at the altar. In front of everybody? Yeah, big deal. Tonight, people are acting like fools at bars all over the city in front of everybody. Acting like idiots in front of everybody. Slobbering, vomiting, falling on the dance floor. Looking like idiots. But boy, you just can't imagine coming down from the balcony and walking down here and getting right with God. Well, let me tell you, friend, 300,000 people have come down to these altars. Why don't you join them? It'll do something to you when you step out, when you break those shackles off of you and come forward and get right with God. Those of you that are backslidden, you're doing things that Jesus would never do. It's time for you to die to those things. The death of Mr. Me. It's time for you to die to those videos you love so much. It's time for you to die to that pornography. It's time for you to die to that adulterous affair. It's time for you to die to that lust. It's time for you to die to that greed, that anger. Whatever it is, it's time for you to lay it down, nail the casket shut, bury it 6 foot under, and never turn back. It's time to die. Backslider, you're going to get down here, you're going to get saved right. You're going to get right with God, and you're never going to turn back. Those of you that are religious, it's time for you to die to your religious ways. Piety. You look right, you smell right, you talk right, but you don't know him. Some of you are upset at me for talking like this. You need to die to that. Your upsetness. Die to that. Because I'm speaking truth to you. Jesus, when he walked the face of this globe, he was always looking at folks that were pious and saying, you whitewashed tombs full of dead men's bones. Outwardly you look so good, but inwardly you're corrupt. And how many would testify that in our churches today, there's so much corruption, there's so much junk. You heard it tonight. This lady, where are you at, sis? That's a Nazarene? Were you a Nazarene? You would go to church, but it didn't mean anything to you. You know, they'd go to church, and then her husband and she would never talk about it. Her husband drank, had alcohol, had all the junk. Going to church every Sunday. Am I telling the truth? Every Sunday. And it's not a Nazarene or a Pentecostal or Baptist. It's the whole lot. Everybody. What a bunch of jokesters we are. What a bunch of hypocrites we are. No wonder the world doesn't want anything to do with us. You can't blame them. It's the truth. Go to church on Sunday and they smell whiskey on your breath on Monday. Why go to church with you on Sunday? So it's time for you to die to this junk, friend, and lay it at the altar. Lay the CDs at the altar. Lay all that junk at the altar and say, Jesus, I'm dying to my religious spirit. You can go to hell, friend, with a choir robe on. You can go to hell with a communion cup in your hand and a wafer in your mouth. You can be the most outstanding young person in your church Boy Scout troop or your Royal Ranger troop. You can be a leader in the church and bust hell wide open if you don't know Jesus. I'm asking you, do you know him? Do you wake up in the morning with Jesus on your heart? Do you go to sleep at night with Jesus on your heart? Do you eat, drink, and breathe Jesus? Listen up at home. Are you consumed with him? Can you taste him? Is he around you all the time? I'm afraid for people in this room. See, here's the type of hypocrites we can be. See that screen? Everything you watch at home, everything we should be able to put on that screen on Sunday morning for church service tomorrow morning. Everything. Some of you are freaking right now over the filthy language you've been listening to on the television. You'd say, I can't do that. I couldn't put that in front of all those people at church. Why? Because it's wrong. It's wrong. And you know it's wrong. Some of the things you said about other people, you know it's wrong. Would you stand up in front of everybody in church, take the microphone, and say the same thing? I don't think so. It's wrong, and you need to repent. Die to all that junk, friend, and let's become Christians. And let the world see a difference. Well, Charity's going to sing Mercy, Mercy Seat, that's undeserved forgiveness. He's going to wash you. He's going to cleanse you. This is a death of Mr. Me. If you need to die tonight to self, if you need to die to something God has been dealing with you about, if you've never known the Lord and you need to die to self and get to know Jesus Christ, if you need to die to a sin in your life, when she sings Mercy Seat, friend, he's going to forgive you. He's going to wash you. I want you to come quickly. I don't want you to hesitate. Everyone who's never known the Lord, everyone who's backslid, everyone who's religious, when she sings Mercy Seat, I want you to come quickly. If you need the Lord to wash you clean and to forgive you, I want you to come right now. Don't hesitate. Don't let pride hold you back. Hurry, hurry right now and kneel at this altar. Kneel at the altar. Kneel at the altar. Come on. Hurry, hurry.
Everything is unknown. I face the power of sin on my own. I did not know.
Come on. Close the altar call. I'm going to close it. If you're coming, come now.
He said that I could come into his presence without fear, into the holy place where his mercy hovers near. I'm running to the mercy seat.
Come on, come on, come on, come on, come on, come on. Hurry! His blood flow freely.
It will provide a healing. I'm running to the mercy seat.
Set him on the seat. On the seat.
Come on. Come on. Come on. Wash me. Wash me. Wash me. Cleanse me. Cleanse me, Jesus. Wash me, Jesus. Come on. God's dealing with your heart. Come on. God's dealing with your heart. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on. God's dealing. Come on. Come on. Come on. I know a place
of mercy for you.
Of mercy for you.
He said that you could come into his presence.
Come on. 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 How about it? It's the death of Mr. Me. It's that one inside of you that never wants to die. That one sin that never wants to give up. That one area you never want to turn over to Jesus Christ. Well, I want to tell you, friend, he's speaking to you. And it's clear, and you know it's clear. Let him have his way in your life. Die to self. You must be crucified with Christ if you're going to live. Ask him right now to wash you. Ask him to cleanse you of every ambition, every sin, every desire, every lust, anything that's in your life, friend, that's drawing you away from God. And let the Lord pull you in tonight. Wash me, Jesus. Wash me, Jesus. Kneel right there. Kneel right there. Come on. 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 Yes. 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 Come on. Come on. Come on.
I'm a running to the mercy seat of Jesus. He's coming. He said his grace would cover me. His blood will flow freely. It will provide the healing. I'm a running to the mercy seat.
Come on down. God bless you. Come on. God bless you. Come on down. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on.
I'm a running to the mercy seat.
We're going to close this altar. We're going to close this altar, but I'm going to do one more thing. Everyone at the altar, keep your heads bowed and your eyes closed. Everyone at the altar, keep your heads bowed. If you just play this softly, Linda, we're not going to, just play this. I want everyone to turn to the person next to them. No, as a matter of fact, bring the team on up. Come on up, guys. I want everyone in this auditorium, those of you at the altar, stay where you're at. But everyone in this auditorium, those of you at home, and those of you in your cars that are with other people in that automobile listening to this broadcast, and if you're in your computer room and you've pulled up the Brownsville website, I want you to turn to the person next to you. Everyone here, turn to the person next to you and ask them this question. Do you need Jesus Christ to forgive you? As a matter of fact, you can ask them if Jesus Christ is dealing with their heart about this. The message tonight. And if the answer is yes, I want both of you to come down together. Don't lie. If the answer is yes, both of you come down together and kneel at this altar and let's get it right with God tonight. Come on right now. God bless you. God bless you. Come on. God bless you. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on. Yes. Yes. That's it. Everyone at the altar, if you haven't come down by now, friend, then your heart is rock. If you're going to come, you better come because I'm going to close. I want everyone at this altar to pray with me right now. Everyone at this altar. There's somebody here that does not understand what's going on. Friend, let me tell you, you're trying to complicate something that's very simple. It is very simple. There is a God in heaven that cares about you. He came down 2,000 years ago in the form of a child called the Christ child. Ever since that time, he has been waiting for you to come to him. See, he came down. Now it's man's responsibility to come to him. Don't ever forget the Christmas story. The shepherds came to Christ. The wise men came to Christ. People came to Christ. It's time for you to come to him. Quit complicating it. If you want to know God, you're going to have to fall on your face and get to know him yourself. Everyone at this altar right now, pray with me out loud. Do not mumble this prayer. Pray with it. Pray with me right now out loud. Dear Jesus, thank you. I've heard from you. Jesus, I want to die to self. This is the death of Mr. Me. I ask you tonight to wash me, cleanse me of every sin in my life. I'm sorry. I confess my sin, and I'm sorry. I ask you tonight to be my Savior, be my Lord, and my very best friend. Jesus, from this moment on, I am yours and you are mine. Come live your life through me. With you as my Lord, I refuse to take over the kingship of my life. You are in charge. You call the shots. I have risen with you. I am in Christ, and you are in me. Live your life through me, Jesus. In your precious name, in Jesus' name, amen. Glory. Hallelujah. Bless the Lord.